Well, good morning, West Ark. It's great to see everybody this morning. What a beautiful Lord's Day morning we have that God has blessed us with. We're going to sing our first song this morning. Sing out with your full voice, please.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Good morning, church. Good morning, those of you joining us online and everyone who's here. I feel like summer started now. We're on the other side of Memorial Day. The summer months have started. I hope that you're out of school. I hope things are still going along. I'll tell you what, there are events and activities planned for this summer. We'd love to tell you more about them. Not only is it West Ark Youth Group, but there's other groups that have things planned coming up in the months ahead, and we'll even be mailing you stuff to tell you about some of that. If you want it, you can get on our email list. So I want to give you an opportunity to get those connections now. If you'll scan this QR code, or if you'll go to westark.org/hello, you can put your information in there so that we can stay in touch with you. You'll go to a little form, and it'll ask you to fill in your contact information, and we're very judicious about that. We keep it strictly to business. We're not going to be selling your information to a third-party vendor or anything like that. But it's really about connection, and that's what we want to do. Actually, now that I think about it, that might be a good idea to start selling it to some third-party vendors. Man, think of all the things we could do if we did. No. See, we won't even do it. That's as long as that thought existed. So there you go. We'll not do that to you. All right. You're not paying any attention to me, are you? I mean, you know, I'm giving you my A material. I'll get better. How's that? Are y'all here? You ready to worship? Yeah? All right. Well, we're so grateful that everyone is here. And we've got a lot to be thankful for and a lot to give praise to God for. So what's our next song, Brent? The Days of Elijah. Now, we got to get our blood moving for that one. So here's what I want you to, I want to ask you to do, and this is our prayer. This is really kind of a prayer. Let's all stand up and stretch. You can do this at home too, okay? Now, I want you, and try to be as genuine as you can. Tell your neighbor about one thing that you're giving thanks to God for this week, okay? And then Brent will come and lead us. But give, share a word of thanksgiving, all right? Why are you thankful to God? Begin.
Let us sing. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, preparing the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and now the Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and now the Zion's hill salvation comes. And now the Zion's hill salvation comes. It's so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saying of the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me beneath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how with me will be with. seated. What a beautiful song that I think, as I think about summer, I can't help to think about this song and how our VBS kids learned this song last summer. And I can't wait for our next VBS, which will be even more exciting, more energetic, more energy, and more songs that we'll get to learn and our little children will get to sing. I can still remember my 2-year-old granddaughter singing this. Waymaker, miracle worker. That's about it. She could sing Waymaker, miracle worker, Waymaker, miracle worker, over and over. But how precious this song that we do have a Waymaker. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
That is who you are.
us pray. Our Father in heaven, that is who you are. You are a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper. Father, we just humbly bow in your presence today. Here worshiping in this place, knowing who you are, knowing that you do make a way when there seems no way. Father, we just thank you that we can blend our voices and sing these praises to you, humbly singing these praises, knowing that you are the Almighty Father. Father, help us to listen to your words that are shared here today about your Son and the words that are written in red. Father, that we can focus on those words and knowing those are the words of Jesus Christ himself through you. Father, we just thank you so much that we can study your word today, that we can gather around your table. Father, that we can grow closer to our brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, that we can ultimately grow closer to you and that relationship with you grow stronger and stronger every day. Father, help us to live out the words that we sing, that you are a way maker. And then we can offer that hope to those who may see no hope in this world. Father, we just thank you for all that you give us and all you've blessed us with. And we give you all the honor and glory and the praise, not just today, but each and every day of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, kiddos, let's come and give for Coins for Christ. Let's sing our song. Let's sing Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. One more time. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. The reason we're singing that song, because such a simple message. Jesus loves me because the Bible tells me so. And we'll talk about that more in a moment. Let us sing.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of God. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful.
Preserved for
So let me ask do a little poll here. How many of you today have a Bible that has the words of Jesus in red? Go ahead and raise your hand if you've got that Bible with you. Okay, you know, or even if you don't have it with you, you've got access to one. So, not a strange thing. A Bible, the words of Jesus printed in red. Have you ever wondered who came up with the idea to do that? And where did that start from? We've got ancient manuscripts where the words of Jesus are in red. It's called the Dominical words, meaning that it's the words of the Lord, Dominus being the Latin term for Lord. But those are expensive manuscripts that to switch over to red ink is quite a luxury. The story of your red letter edition of the Bible goes back to 1899. There was a publisher. He had become a Christian. His name was Louis Klopsch. He was the editor of a magazine called the Christian Herald. And he was inspired by the words that we often read around the communion table, Luke 22, where Jesus says, "This is the New Testament in my blood." And in writing this article, he wondered, what would it be like to have a New Testament where the words of Jesus are printed in red? So he was a fan of a well-known preacher in the 1890s named the Reverend Thomas DeWitt Talmage. He contacts Talmage and he says, "What do you think of this idea?" And Talmage says, "It could do no harm, and it most certainly could do much good." And so in 1901, Klopsch publishes the first red letter edition of the New Testament. And in the notes he explains, modern Christianity, now remember he's in 1901. He says, "Modern Christianity is striving to zealously draw nearer to the great founder of the faith, setting aside mere human doctrines and theories regarding him. The red letter Bible has been prepared and issued in the full conviction that it will meet the needs of the student, the worker, and the searchers after truth everywhere." And I think this is the spirit behind our expression that I pay a lot of attention to the words in red. And we're going to bring some of those up as we go along this summer looking at this. But let's use the intent that Klopsch had, that the Reverend Talmage said it can't do any harm and it could only do some good, to really receive this not just as dead letters on a page, but as the living word of the Lord. And especially those that are printed in red, these are the words of Jesus himself. And one thing about that is, you can read Shakespeare and read what he wrote. You can read Mark Twain and his sayings. You can even read C.S. Lewis and the things that he wrote outside of his fictional tales, and they're very rewarding. But when we read the words of Jesus, when we hear the words of Jesus, he is still very much a living author. And we can ask him to explain that to us. We can commune with him. And as we discussed in the class this morning, how much more is the Father willing to give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? So it's in that spirit that I want to ask the Lord to give us that understanding as we read these words. Would you pray with me? Father, we ask that your kingdom would come and that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. We do indeed know that the church represents the kingdom, but Father, we confess to you that within ourselves, we are pockets of rebellion. We are little islands of resistance to the rule of God Almighty in this world. And Father, we ask that your kingdom be fully established in all ways. And we want to be a part of that rule. And so that means we want your help and your Holy Spirit so that we can put these words into practice and be like the wise man who builds a house on the rock. Father, don't lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lead us away from the temptation to go our own way, to do our own thing, to believe that we control these words. And instead, we ask for your Spirit that humbles us and teaches us to be obedient to you. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I guess the place to start is with John 3:16. But I want you to hear this, not as a slogan, but as the words of Jesus himself. And I'll give you the context in just a moment, but give your attention to the reading of God's word. Jesus himself says, "For God loved the world in this way. He gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And anyone who believes in him is not condemned, but anyone who does not believe is already condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son of God." That's just three verses of this larger context, but these quite familiar words, in fact, probably too familiar, and in their familiarity, we've sort of dismissed the impact of these words. And we need to hold them again, and we need to certainly learn not to entrust these words simply to chaps like Roland Stewart. Some of you, if you were watching sports during the 70s or 80s, you'll remember Roland Stewart. Hey guys, this is what we had for memes in the 70s and 80s right here. You couldn't come up with a meme, you had to become a meme. And that's what Roland Stewart did. He put on his rainbow wig and his John 3:16 t-shirt, and he knew how to move himself out to get attention. He first shows up at the 1977 NBA Finals. He found out how to get in front of the camera. He had become a born-again Christian, and he decided that he wanted everybody to pay attention to John 3:16. That was his little slogan. Oh, it caught on. In fact, at the 1979 Major League Baseball All-Star Game, the cameramen and the commentators were trying to figure out how to get the camera off of him. Some people say he was more entertaining than the game. But he figured out ways then to get out in front of the camera at the Olympics, at whatever event it might be, because he thought everybody needs to know this verse. In time, he did in fact become a meme. Nobody was really paying attention to John 3:16. They were just paying attention to 3:16 and the man with the rainbow wig. And so other celebrities started coming up with their own 3:16s. Roland Stewart even figured out how to get into the pit crew at Indianapolis 500 to show off his rainbow wig and his 3:16. Anything to get attention. But by the late 80s, Roland Stewart had become something of a nuisance. He went around to churches, high-profile churches, TV stations, religious broadcasters, and finally the American Music Awards, and he was setting off stink bombs. And his message was, God thinks that this stinks. Now, how do you go from John 3:16, God so loves the world that he sends his Son not to condemn, to setting off stink bombs? I think the dye in Roland Stewart's rainbow wig had gotten to him. Since 1992, and just to complete the story, Roland Stewart has been serving time, three life sentences, in fact. They take that born-again stuff seriously, you know. And so three life sentences at the Mule Creek State Penitentiary in California. Because Roland's final act was to put posters of John 3:16 up in the windows of his motel room, and he was telling the authorities that he was going to be shooting at planes taking off from LAX. He got a lot of attention for that. Folks, 3:16 is not some gospel in a nutshell meant only for nuts. These are the words of Jesus. It's his testimony. Jesus is giving us his testimony about who he is and what he's all about. It comes up in the context of a conversation that Jesus is having with one of the teachers of Israel, Nicodemus. I like Nicodemus. He's a scholar. He's a teacher. He's a smart man. He's even smart enough to recognize that there's something about Jesus. He doesn't just give in to his fear. There's a lot of intelligent people, a lot of people who know Scripture really well. But when they get nervous and intimidated, they reject things that don't fit into their worldview. Nicodemus can see that, hey, there's something about this Jesus. And so he goes to him and he says, you must be a teacher sent by God. Because no one could do the things that you do if he wasn't a teacher sent by God. Now, what Nicodemus doesn't know is that Jesus is even more than a teacher sent by God. And so in their discussion, Jesus says, you know, you can't see the kingdom of heaven unless you're born anew. And there's something about this word, being born anew, that Nicodemus doesn't quite grasp. That's because in saying born anew, this phrase might also be interpreted born from above. And where Jesus is indicating you have to be born from the origin of heaven, you have to be born from above, Nicodemus is thinking, wait, born a second time? How do you do that? How do you go back to the womb? How does that happen? What does rebirth have to do with anything involving the kingdom? Nicodemus is having to get a new category for his understanding of the things of God. That's how powerful this verse, this testimony of Jesus is. I mean, we might take it for granted, but for Nicodemus, it requires him to build a whole new set of tools and handles. He has to go get a new kind of container to put this truth in. Now, Jesus marvels at the fact that Nicodemus is a teacher of Israel, but he can't perceive the spiritual reality of the kingdom and being born anew. He says, you're Israel's teacher, and this is kind of a stretch for you. I don't think Jesus is being insulting. I think he's just noticing the fact that this is a huge concept. And afterwards, John the Baptist, in this same context, recognizes that Jesus' authority does not come from any authority based on earth. That if you want to know, okay, well, who gives Jesus the authority to say these things? You remember that when Saul went out to round up believers in Jesus, that when Saul went out to arrest them because they were dangerous, he carried with him letters of authority from the Sanhedrin. Here's a man thinking that he's doing what is religiously right, backed by a religious authority on earth, and he's dead wrong. And it's when Jesus represents the authority from heaven in Acts 9 that he says to Saul, why are you persecuting me? Not my church, but me. When you persecute them, you persecute me. And Saul has to get a new bucket to put things in because now he understands the weight of this testimony. John the Baptist, who came before Jesus, says, oh no, we're not talking, this is no rival of mine. This is not somebody who rivals me. If I'm decreasing so that he can increase, so be it. He's not just a competing preacher. His authority comes from above. His authority comes from God because he is the Son of God. John the Baptist believes and understands the testimony that Jesus says about himself right in the middle of this context. Finally, the gospel, the chapter in the gospel, chapter 3, is wrapped up by a statement that the one from above is above all. So if we really want to see the kingdom rule of God, if we want to see how the kingdom controls and permeates the church and our lives and our world, we've got to have a new bucket, a new container, a new mindset, a new worldview of everything. We have to be born anew of the water and spirit. That's the context of this. So that's just the container that this verse sets in. It's the setting for the pearl of these words in red. What Jesus is saying, first of all, is God loves the world. God's not out to get the world. God loves the world. He loves the world enough to give the world His Son. First of all, do we understand what the love of God means? Because I think it's much deeper and greater than what we conceive of. We reduce love to an emotion, to a feeling, maybe to a state of being. But love is a set of actions, and it is a lifestyle. It is God, John says. God is love. God loves the world enough to give His only Son because His love demands more than a memo. You know, we might send love letters to someone, but that's never going to suffice. We can't just send a memo that says, hey, just a memo to everybody. I want to remind you, I do love you. Thank you for your time. We'll have a meeting at 10:30 later today. You need more than a memo. You need more than a manual. God doesn't say to us as our Heavenly Father, hey, I love you so much. Hey, here's a book. Read it. There'll be a test later. God doesn't love us so much that He says, you know, I love you guys, but you're a mess. Somebody's going to have to teach you how to behave. Here, listen to this teacher. I've hired this person to be a nanny for you. I'm out of here. Come back when you've learned. This love demands more than a prophet and a regent who were heavenly spokespeople, heavenly commanders and directors of the nations that claim to follow God. What is needed because of love is the very Son of God Himself. The one who is like the Father and is the Father. The one who represents the exact likeness of the Father. I'm going to send my Son. That's how much God wants to be known by us. That He doesn't just stand far off, but He represents Himself in His Son. That's the first impact of this. But why give the Son? Why does He have to go to that level? And why the verb give? I mean, He sends His Son, but why give? Why does it say He gave His Son? Are we just talking about His sacrifice? You know, we're talking about the sacrifice and more. He gives His Son to give eternal life to all who trust in the Son. I want you to think about this right now, that what we've just read from the words of Jesus, what Jesus is saying right now is, God wants you to have eternal life. Some of us have lived our whole lives thinking that we're probably bound for hell. That if we step foot in a church, it'd come crumbling down around us. I may not make it into heaven. I'll barely make it. Yeah, if it's all up to you, you'll barely make it, and so will I. But do you understand that God's desire is for you to have eternal life? To be saved. That's God's desire. Well, yeah, you say that, preacher, but some people need to repent. Sure, we all need to repent. You say that, preacher, but how do you get to speak for God? Well, I didn't make this idea up. It's not my notion. My notion would probably look for something very different than this. The people I like get eternal life. The people I don't like, they've been handy. That's what humans do, and that's why we're so messed up and need salvation. But God loves you enough that He wants you to have eternal life, and He wants you to trust in His Son. God gives His Son to save a world that is doomed by its evil. You know, I find myself, unfortunately, and I'm being confessional, church, I find myself often in moments of anger, in moments of disgust, in moments of just general frustration, cursing the world. People are this, people are that, the world is this, the world is that, I don't like it. That's just me being an angry 2-year-old in a 50-something body, okay? Don't like, hate. It's a childish mindset. And I'm confessing to it. What I have to remember in those moments, and maybe this helps you, what I have to remember is this, that God made this world and He cares about it. That God made all of us and He cares about it. And He's not willing to let it go, no matter how broken, how corrupted, how messed up it's gotten. No matter how much I may hate it and be upset and angry, God wants to redeem it. God wants to save it. So whereas I'm willing to put on my spiritual hard hat and go around and tack signs on the world that say, condemned, 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 God is ripping them off and saying, hey, I didn't appoint you to that task. Not even my own son came to condemn the world. He's on a rescue mission. And if you want to help him, then put on your life vest and get in there and help him do the rescuing. God gave his son to save a world that's doomed by its own evil. God gave his son to speak God's truth and to give the Holy Spirit. Right there at the end of the chapter, he says that God will give the Holy Spirit. I didn't put that on the slide, so let's take a gander. Give a listen to John 3 right there at the end, because I think those comments, they may not be words in red, but they're an important interpretation of what's being said. It's probably the words of John the Baptist. He has come from above and is greater than anyone else. We are of the earth and we speak of earthly things. But he has come from heaven and is greater than anyone else. He testifies about what he has seen and heard, but how few believe what he tells them. Anyone who accepts his testimony can confirm that God is true. For he is sent by God. He speaks God's words. For God gives him the Spirit without limit. The Father loves his Son and has put everything into his hands. And anyone who believes in God's Son has eternal life. Anyone who doesn't obey the Son will never experience eternal life, but remains under God's judgment. There is condemnation. It's a kind of self-condemnation where we don't trust in the Son. But if we trust in the Son, He has authority to give the Spirit, and that's His desire. In Romans 8:1, the words are, there's no condemnation for those who are in Jesus. Now, that might make us nervous because we think, well, wait, is this some kind of license then? That means I can do whatever I want. I've been given a hall pass to do anything, right? Don't abuse it like that. That's not what it means. It means that the sentence, the condemnation, it's been expunged, it's been dropped. It's been done away with. We've been set free is what it means. Free to live for Him. The mission of Jesus is to save, not to condemn. We know how to condemn. Jesus comes into a world that knows that the law stands against it, knows the weight of condemnation. He comes to a nation of people who understand that they have had to pay for their sins. They've had to repent. They've been in exile. God redeems them. They go through other exiles. God redeems them. Jesus' mission is, there's an end of condemnation. Now comes the salvation. When we recognize that we have sinned, and Paul goes through this in Romans 8. When we recognize that we have sinned, we have achieved something. Because we know that we're condemned. Now comes the salvation part. Now what do we got to do to be saved? You trust in the Son. You obey Him. You follow Him. And that includes all the things that you and I do. I mean, you know, somebody will say, well, do I have to be baptized? Well, yeah, you're going to be baptized because Jesus was baptized. I mean, that's what He does. Follow Him. Follow Him through baptism. That's born anew. Born from above. You're going to be more and more like Him. You're going to do these things. But now you're living the saved, redeemed, rescued life. The light is here. That's what John the Baptist says about Jesus. The light is here. This is what Jesus says about Himself. The light is here. Now, you can embrace the light or you can reject it. Sometimes when we're evil, and maybe it's because we desire the things that tempt us, or maybe it's because we're ashamed, maybe it's because we're so self-condemned that we don't see another way, that what we end up doing is we end up rejecting the light. Jesus is letting us know that in that light there is the love and there is the salvation of God if we will trust in Him, believe Him. So the question I want you to think about is, are we born from above into the kingdom of God? Have we experienced that? Some of you may have experienced that. You may have been baptized, and yet, you know, maybe you didn't really experience that birth from above. I can't, each case is a little, you have to talk about it, but I can tell you that Jesus points us to a way where we understand that being baptized into Him, it's for the removal of those sins and that sinful nature. Being baptized into Him is to be born anew so that there is no condemnation for those who are in Jesus Christ. Here's what I want you to know. I want you to know that I'm not inviting you to baptism. Jesus is. That's why God sent His Son. This is what I ask you to think about today. If this is your past experience, that you were born from above, and maybe it hasn't been quite what you thought. Like I said in my prayer, sometimes we are pockets of rebellion in the kingdom. Well, Jesus has come to save. If your baptism into Jesus Christ is a future situation, then let's talk about what it means to get you ready for that, to prepare you for that. I believe that this is going to be a good summer where a lot of people are going to be thinking about what that decision means. And what I want you to know is that decision is both an end and a beginning. It is the end to the earthly things of this world, and it is the beginning of living in the kingdom. It is the beginning of life in Christ. And I wouldn't want you to miss out on the joy of being in the kingdom for a single moment. Now, today, as we've done before, if after this service you need to talk to somebody about that, you've got your shepherds, you've got people here, you've got ministers here, let's have some conversations about this. I know that it can be scary to come up front. I know it can be scary to be baptized in front of everyone. I want you to know that there's nothing magic about that baptistry. It's meaningful to us because this is the family's living room. But based on what Jesus says, the words in red, being baptized into Christ is what counts. Being baptized into Him is what has meaning. We're going to gather around the Lord's Supper table this morning. And often that becomes a time where we feel like we're not welcome because we're condemned. If you've been baptized into Jesus Christ, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We don't come proud of our accomplishments. We come humble, accepting the invitation of the One who loves us enough that when His Father said, "I'm sending you to save," He was obedient. And likewise, we ought to be obedient as well. We're going to sing this song, and we're going to gather around the Lord's Supper table this morning.
Well, let's go ahead and stand as we sing, please.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if He did. All authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory.
Good morning. Welcome to the table of the Lord. Chris made a couple of important points, and you got to be careful when you say something with a P in it with this microphone. Peter and Paul, you got to be real careful when you slip up on those. He made a couple of very important points. That is, I know with certainty, a lot of people don't feel worthy of partaking in the Lord's Supper for whatever reason. As an attorney, I will tell you that when a person accepts Christ and is baptized into him, it's right there in Romans, he is justified by judicial decree. Don't argue with the judge. You don't understand it? Okay. You're justified. After that, you begin the process of working out your salvation. But the justification, the imputation of all of Christ's righteousness belongs to the person who accepts him. When we come to this table, we remember Jesus because he asked us to do so. We do it weekly. The proper view for that is spiritual. And that's easy to say, but it's hard to do. Because those two views in life will always be competing with us. Jesus was not trapped at Gethsemane. He knew he'd removed himself so that there wouldn't be what we call collateral damage associated with his arrest. He was not killed. He was not murdered. Not a martyr. He is a sacrifice, a voluntary sacrifice. Huge difference. And a difference because only Jesus could be a sacrifice. Wages of sin's death. All of sin has come short of the glory of God. We can't do it. Nobody could do it for us. He was righteous, holy from the beginning. Only he could pay that sacrifice for our sin. Nobody else could. There's no backup plan. He was it. Probably had something to do with the sweat drops of blood. We have, often when we come to this part of the service, we talk about the physical punishment that the Lord endured. But everything about that story, viewed from the standpoint of the spiritual, is fascinating. Much more fascinating than just someone was arrested and crucified. Would you pray with me, please? Our Father, as we partake of these emblems, we remember the master of this feast who voluntarily allowed his body to be sacrificed for us, and he had no sin. We know that. He was wounded for our transgressions. As we partake of this bread, we do so with great love and humility for the sacrifice that you gave and that he made for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Pray with me again, please. Our Father, as we partake of this cup, we remember the blood that Christ shed on Calvary's cross for us. We remember his scourging, crown of thorns, the nails, All of this was done to atone for sins that we committed. And we ask for your forgiveness. And we ask that we honor him with this and with every day of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Barry, for leading us around the Lord's Supper table. And I want to thank everybody for their generosity and for giving. These are ways that we've set it up for you to do the discipline of giving every week. This is also how you can give to special occasions, to special ministries, particular needs within the congregation. Now, I want to tell you about one that begins today. This is what we call our baby bottle campaign. Some of you may know this. We've done this now for years. This is an effort to support the work of the First Choice Pregnancy Help Center. They're just right up the road here. But this is like a few different, similar ministries. Not different, but similar ministries. It's an alternative to abortion. Now, this is timelier than ever right now. We had the Walk for Life recently to support that work, and we are doing this where we are going to collect these baby bottles. You're going to pick up the bottles today if you want to give to this. Just put your spare change in it. You can put folding money checks in there if you want, and then we're going to gather them back up on August 7th, and we're going to give them to those folks who are doing that work. Let me tell you, down at First Choice, what they've got is they've got people. And those people are there to receive other people who find themselves in a difficult situation where they're going to bring a life into this world, and they're going to need a lot of support to do it. And that's what the ministry is about. Here's the thing. In this day and age, you have people who say, well, if all you Christians are opposed to abortion, are you going to do something to help the people who have these children? Yes. And we have been. And it won't be perfect, but we're going to do our best. And through ministries like this, through ministries like the Foster Closet, where we support those who are taking care of children, who are in those situations that we're told, well, these procedures will eliminate all of that. Good luck with that. I don't believe it. And just because the laws of this land change, human behavior is still going to be the same. And there's still going to be battles. There's still going to be pregnancies. And there's still going to be a lot of doubt and fear surrounding that. And there's going to be bad options. And there's going to be better options. We've got to support the work of the kingdom in this way. So if you get all upset and worried about the political battle that's going on, I mean, we already got the preview of whatever the Supreme Court's going to decide, and now we're just waiting for the real deal, and then everybody who's selling you media is going to tell you why you should be upset about it one way or another. They don't care as long as you're mad and just keep coming back for more. Keep coming to the trough because we want to sell you some outrage. All sides get outrage. Give up on the outrage, folks. Let's support the good. Let's do what Christ calls us to do. They say that in the second century, by the way, none of this stuff is nothing new, unwanted children, they weren't always aborted. They were often exposed. That meant you had a baby and you just leave it out to die. They say that Christians, we're talking maybe 100, 150 years into Christianity, that Christian believers, because of what they believed about God and what they believed about teaching, what they believed about Jesus Christ, they would go and rescue those children and raise them as their own. And that's probably why the church grew. But even if that's not the reason why, that was the right thing, the godly thing to do. We're just asking you to put change in a baby bottle. But we'll do that and much more. May God help us. We're going to sing one more song, and then I want to send us out. What's our next song? Where He Leads Me, I Will Follow. Okay, before we do that, I want to ask our shepherds to stand up, the shepherds of this congregation. Would you guys stand up and be recognized? Brent's one of those. Barry, you saw him do the Lord's Supper. I want to remind you again who these men are that have been recognized by the congregation to be spiritual leaders. And the reason why is because they're going to be throughout this congregation and there. And I mentioned to you that if you have things that you want to talk about, go to them. And it's not just limited to them, but they're certainly among those that you can talk to. So let's stand and sing, and then we'll be dismissed in prayer.
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take my cross and follow me. Where He leads me, I will follow. Where He
even as it is in heaven. Father, we commit to following You, and we do so humbly, knowing that it's not always easy. Lead us away from temptation and deliver us from evil. Father, go with us now. You have prepared ways for us to serve You and to bring glory to Your name. Teach us to know the joy of being obedient in service to You. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.